I assembled this e-bike all by myself. I chose the motor, the battery, the seat, the handlebar. Even the pedals and the stand were picked up for my specific needs. That's what makes this bike so special, and there's nothing I want to change about it. Wait a second, there's an email. Hi Luke, I really enjoyed your videos. We'd love to send you one egg rider. Hi everybody, this is Luke, and yes, in a previous video I said that the egg rider was a great option to consider, but that I consider it a bit overkill for my personal daily use. Well, today we'll consider it for real. I will talk about my real experience on this 500W Bafan kit to see how you can leverage the feature of this tiny, smart display. Let's get started. When I first installed my Bafang BBS02B, I started to investigate how the programming tool worked in order to have the best profile for everyday experience. If you missed that content, I suggest you check that out first. Before installing the egg rider, the first thing you're supposed to do is to back up your Bafang configuration. I recommend doing it with the Bafang programming cable connected to the PC. This is because the egg rider happens to write some settings directly on your controller, de facto reprogramming the motor as you change them. Since it is a generic display that also happens to work on Bafang kits, it lacks a backup feature so far. Having your own backup will allow you to roll back to your previous setup in case you need it. The egg rider we'll see today will be the V2, the small black and white one. There is another version out now, which is the C1, and probably another one will come out pretty soon. But for today, let's see the V2. The first issue I faced was this no ASI settings when I first turned the display on. We'll see how to fix this in a moment, and from now on, the video will be mostly screen records made from my Android phone. So I head over to the Play Store and downloaded the Egg Rider app. The app itself might seem a bit old, but consider that a newer version is in development right now, and that today we'll see which features already exist to begin with. After the splash and the welcome screens, the app will require you to grant the GPS and nearby devices permission. Then it will ask for the notification permission. At first, I didn't allow it, but reading more carefully, you'll see it uses this permission to keep the connection alive between the display and the app. So I went over to app settings and granted them again. Once you click on the active display, you'll see this control panel with real-time data. To close it, you can click the settings button. The first thing we want to do is going to the display settings, where we can decide to change, among other things, the protocol. See, this is what was causing the previous no ASI settings message. We need to be explicit about the motor we are using. Selecting Bafang will allow the display to communicate with the kit in its own language. Oh, a couple of things to mention. A single click of the power button will be sufficient. The display remembers your last selected assist level. Nice! Long pressing the minus button will turn on the 6V light. Long pressing the plus button will activate the walking assistance. Back to the display settings. On screen are some of the options we can customize. Road restrict is very interesting, because we can choose to change the ride mode, road, off-road, only if the app is connected, preventing anyone else to do it without our phone. I will also select startup with road mode, yes. 5 levels of assistance as usual, and the short press of the mode button will show statistics to prevent misclicks. Now, if I want to change the ride mode, I'll be forced to connect the app first. About the Bafang switching mode, if we want to take full advantage of the two ride modes, we need to select live data and settings. The reason is explained in the Bafang basic section if you select the I button. Here we can specify the wheel size, and we also want to spend some time specifying our battery settings. I personally have 2 batteries of the same size, but I prefer to fill all the 3 battery slots. And finally, let's write our settings. From now on, the motor and the display will be able to communicate. In the app settings, there's more stuff we can edit, but I will simply change the mean speed to consider the ride as started, 2 km/h. In the Bafang basic settings, we can actually program our kit based on the current riding mode. For road, besides limiting the current to 15 ampere, I want to have a linear profile maxed at 50% of my total current. How do I do it? Remember my profile chart? Let me make a copy of it, and then let me go to linear profile. If you remember the functions, all current values were depending on the last level, 100%. Which means that if I change it down to 50, all the other values will readapt linearly. Nice, these are the values that I want my road mode to be set to. For off-road instead, I will set the current to 25 amps and copy all the assist levels from the smart profile of the spreadsheet. It's good to reuse some previous work instead of reinventing the wheel, right? Don't forget to write every time you change something on the Bafang tabs to apply for each ride mode. All the remaining Bafang tabs, I left them as they were. Just remember that the torque tab is useless for BBS series motors. After configuring the display, I went outside for a test drive, starting by settings with road mode. As expected, the motor behaved like a 250W rated one, thanks to the 50% linear profile. One of the advantages of the Egg Rider is the ability to remember the last selected assist level, so I don't have to set it every time I turn on the bike. I can finally leave it at level 5 for both riding modes. A feature I lost instead from my P850C colorful LCD display is the light sensor, which turns the 6V light on or off depending on the daylight. This is something I would add in the future. Once outside of the public way, I opened up the app to connect it to the display, this way allowing myself to switch to off-road riding mode. This restores my so-called smart profile that I'm used to. This safety feature is very good, because it allows only me to use this profile, and not some other inexperienced person that wants to try out my e-bike. With this mode, I enjoyed those wonderful country roads. To summarize, the Egg Rider project is great. The existence of a single display which adapts to so many e-bike protocols makes it already an outstanding project. Thank you very much, George, for the possibility to try the V2. Once configured correctly, it does exactly what you would expect. The first configuration is maybe a bit tricky for a new user, but this is where videos like this one come to the rescue. I also can't wait to try out the new app. One of the issues I have with this one is the sudden close of the app if you hit the back button from within one of the tabs. This is a bit frustrating because you have to open it again. I would have preferred going to the previous screen or at least to the connection one. Also, it would help to have next to each setting a help feature which can quickly explain what that particular one is about. That could also be less scary than having to browse a big instruction manual. That said, I love this little display. I really hope to try out another one in the near future. That's why I suggest you to subscribe to the channel. And what about you? Have you tried the Egg Rider? What do you think about it? If you enjoyed this video, feel free to hit the like button. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you on the next one.